Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for coming, and welcome also to anyone watching online. If you'd like to tweet today, could you use the hashtag OMS10? And if you are watching online, I'm very happy to take questions via Twitter, and we'll try and get to them in among the hands in the room as well. I'm very, very pleased to introduce our speaker today. Professor Julian Savulescu has been one of our key academics working across a wide number of programs from the very early days of the Oxford Martin School. He's one of the co-directors on one of our newest programs, the Oxford Martin Program on Collective Responsibility for Infectious Disease. For those of you who attended last week and saw Angela McLean, they're working together on that. He's also involved in the geoengineering project, resource stewardship, vaccines, and is co-director and set up the Institute for Science and Ethics. So he's got a list of OMS credits as long as your arm. And as if that weren't enough, he holds the chair, the Yahiro Chair in Practical Ethics. He's director of the Oxford Centre for Neuroethics and director of the Oxford Yahiro Centre for Practical Ethics. So I think I better just introduce Julian Savulescu.
Thanks very much, Carol, and it's an enormous privilege to be here on the 10th anniversary of the Martin School, and I'd like to thank the Martin School for all of their support, but I'd especially like to thank Jim Martin and also Lillian Martin. I met Jim before the school was established, and it's been one of the privileges in my life to meet Jim, and he was a truly visionary man, and I am deeply impressed and motivated by his vision. Jim's idea was that this century provides one of the greatest challenges that has ever faced humanity in terms of its opportunities and its risks. Its technological advance and its globalization has enabled humans to go where we've never been before, and that offers the opportunity for unprecedentedly good lives, but also the threat of extinction. I am not going to talk so much today about the risks, although increasingly over the recent years I've been more motivated by concerns around existential risks, and my colleague Nick Bostrom has written on this in terms of artificial intelligence. I'm going to talk today about the prospect of the benefits, because over the last 10 years I've been quite exercised over the prospect of modifying our biology to improve our lives. And I'm going to start off in the first half by talking about some of the prospects, and obviously I can't cover everything, and this is going to be a very selective and chaotic overview. And then I'm going to talk about some of the lessons that I've learned over the last 10 years and the ways I've started to think about these issues. So doping in sport is an example of safe, effective human enhancement. It's clear that it works. It's clear that it gives you an advantage. And it raises the question of what kind of rules we should place over biologically enhancing ourselves. And the current experiment in doping is what's called zero tolerance. We have a complete ban on any kind of physical performance enhancement. This is the 1988, I think it was, Seoul Olympics. Ben Johnson won and was a very high-profile doper. He was found to be taking anabolic steroids. He was also taking growth hormone, which has never been picked up by any assays. It turned out that six of the eight runners there have been subsequently proven to be doping, and that's in general the rule in the sprint events. So everyone's very surprised about these recent events in Russia and so on, and then Kenya, and spreads to allegations in Ethiopia and Jamaica and so on. But it's really not surprising. I've been, again, for over 10 years watching sort of this unfold, and what's surprising is that people are still surprised. So these are the people who are run under 9.8 seconds or less, And I think 8 of 10 have been implicated in doping, and only 2 haven't been, Usain Bolt being one of them. But as Ben Johnson said in an interview, if you want to run under 10 seconds, the level of training that you have to do will inevitably cause injuries, and to recover from those injuries, you have to take steroids. 1/3 of Olympic medals since about the year 2000 have been associated with suspicious blood values on independent analysis by Michael Ashenden several months ago. And studies of anonymous reporting put the figure at around 1/3, and that's probably an underestimate of the number. So it's hardly surprising that, you know, there are many people implicated in doping from Russia, but the same will be true in the US, where many of the most high-profile cases, Marion Jones and so on, have been involved. So doping is just a very ordinary, familiar form of enhancement. Now, why do we dope, and why is there such a prospect for enhancing human performance? I take an evolutionary picture of human beings, and that, on that view, we're just the blind products of evolution. We weren't designed for any particular purpose, and we certainly weren't designed to be saints. And enhancement offers the human animal, the opportunity to overcome the significant limitations that are built into our biology. And of course, because of our dispositions to cheat, free ride, exploit, and harm others, we're going to need rules to control our behaviour. And those rules need to be based on facts about the human animal, not idealised representations or hyper-romantic visions of human psychology, which often dominate the bases for regulation. So in many ways, we're like other animals, like flies. We've evolved for a certain kind of niche. And as a result of human evolution, we vary. This is just the normal variation in hematocrit, or the percentage of red blood cells. So the reason why doping is so hard to detect... Does this thing work? The reason why... Because this is the normal range. Now, if you use human erythropoietin or blood doping or altitude training or hypoxic air tent to push you out to here, it's very easy to pick up because you're way outside of this normal range. But if you happen to be lucky and be born here with a hematocrit of 50, you've got an enormous advantage in distance and endurance events over somebody with a natural hematocrit of 42. And it's very easy to get from 42 to 50. You can take EPO, blood dope, train at altitude, go into a hypoxic air tent. And it's very difficult for scientists and the World Anti-Doping Agency to work out whether you got to 50 naturally or whether you're using a manipulation of your own physiology. So it's extremely difficult. That's the whole idea of a biological passport, was introduced to try to pick up these variations within normal. Okay, but they fail because it's normal. It's very difficult, unless you've got 24-hour surveillance, to work out whether somebody is cheating. So being able to move across this range is enormously beneficial to people, and also outside of the range. But notice that it's much easier to pick up somebody with an abnormal value than it is within this normal range. So physiological doping, or doping within a normal range, as sport has shown, is going to be very difficult to pick up. Now, these normal variations have importance not just in physical performance, but in every single area of life. Every feature about human beings varies. And this is the IQ curve, but I could have drawn a curve for impulse control or empathy or hearing or vision or anything, any property that human beings have. Now, the IQ curve has enormous implications for what you can do in life. You need an IQ of about 90 to fill in a tax return in the US. And as the US military has realised, even normal people don't function satisfactorily as foot soldiers now. So even at the Second World War, they were excluding the bottom 10% of normals, and now they exclude the bottom 30%. So this area of 70 to 85 is normal, but it's now described as low normal, and these individuals are significantly advantaged. Indeed, the US Department of Education conducts a literacy survey every year And it estimates that the people in the bottom two levels of five, which constitute nearly 50% of the US population, lack the abilities to enjoy the rights and responsibilities of citizenship. This isn't saying that IQ is all biological. What it's saying is that normal variation, partly determined by biology, partly determined by your choices and partly determined by your environment, will have a profound effect on what sort of job you can do or what opportunities you have. All of you will probably have an IQ of greater than 120, enables you to go to university. Even such a fundamental area as our close personal relationships and romantic relationships, of course, have the limitations and structures that are written into our biology. The most highly coded behaviour of animals is their mating behaviour. And we weren't designed as human animals to live to 85 and to have marriages that went for 50 or 60 years. The average human relationship through virtually all of human history would have been 7 to 10 years, where one partner would have died, typically the female in childbirth, typically the male through violence. And that's precisely the mean duration of marriages today. So once your relationship goes beyond the time period necessary to rear young, biologically, in a sense, you're living on borrowed time. That's not to say you can't and you can't enjoy it and it can't be good for you, but you face limitations. So when people say, oh, the divorce rate is 50%, that's a bad thing, that's an ethical evaluation. And it may be that it's a good thing and it may be we can use biology to overcome it. I've been particularly exercised in the last few years, 5 years, over the role of biological limitation on our moral decisions. And people say, oh no, come on, you know, biology doesn't influence, you know, what we think is right and wrong. Well, there's lots of evidence that it does. And this is my favourite study. I'm sorry if some of you have heard this before. This is a study of Israeli judges and their willingness to offer parole decisions. And it found that the longer the period between the time the judge last ate breakfast, lunch or dinner and the case, the less likely they were to offer parole. And this was very statistically significant. Now, it's not morally relevant to a case how far it is from the time the judge last ate the meal. Now, maybe these were too lenient or these were too severe, or we have no independent way of telling what the right level of severity is, but it shouldn't vary just according to time. Other studies have shown that a testosterone level in the morning for traders on a strong market predicts their earnings that day. It reduces cognitive empathy in women, reduces interpersonal trust, is associated with rejection of unfair offers, and paradoxically is associated with increased fair bargaining. Now, that's not to say that testosterone is a moral de-enhancer or enhancer. What it shows is that the level of a hormone affects morally relevant behaviour. Now, many of the problems that we face today, like climate change or terrorism, are the result not of purely external events like asteroids striking us or the emergence of new epidemics. Most of these events are the result of choices that we make, of behaviour, of human moral decisions, decisions to consume or not consume, the decisions to kill or not kill. And they're the result of human limitation. Climate change is a global tragedy of the commons. It's a result of the inability of humans over populations of millions or tens or hundreds of millions to cooperate, where their contributions make small changes that they can't see and they have no particular reason to cooperate or trust others. And the tendency to free ride is great and the ability to detect free riders is small. So how the human animal, through virtually all of human history, the 300 or so thousand years of human history, managed tragedy of the commons, was it in small scale, where you had a pasture and a group of herdsmen who could each see each other and trusted each other, and free riders could be punished. But that's not what happens when it comes to global commons. Our psychology, our moral psychology, is not set up for those sorts of dilemmas. And although at the moment we've seen recently this terrible tragedy in Paris and September 11th, terrorists have used things that go bang, it's only a matter of time before terrorists decide to use things that go bigger bang, like nuclear devices, or things that don't go bang but kill hundreds of millions of people, like smallpox or biological weapons that can be constructed in a small-scale laboratory in a backyard. Okay, so that's the sort of landscape. How could biology help? Well, the second commonest export in the world is caffeine. It's a performance enhancer, and we have performance enhancements in many areas of life. Modafinil, I'll talk about, human growth hormone, EPO and steroids I've talked about, Ritalin, cosmetic surgery and tattooing, and Viagra are all examples of attempts to use knowledge of biology to improve human performance. There are many forms of cognitive enhancement, and they continue to improve in effectiveness. Once drugs are effective for treating the memory loss in Alzheimer's disease, they'll of course be useful in age-related memory loss and then even in normal people. So we just had a very interesting discussion with some colleagues in neuroscience involved in deep brain stimulation and the prospects of deep brain stimulation for improving conditions like memory or other conditions shows the extension beyond diseases like Parkinson's disease and depression. One of the most fundamental traits that affects how people's lives go is what's called impulse control, or the ability to delay gratification. In the 1960s, Walter Mischel conducted his famous impulse control experiments on four-year-old children. You can see these on YouTube. He placed a marshmallow in front of a four-year-old child and told the child, if you don't eat this one, when I come back in the room, I'll give you two. And they attempt various strategies to withstand temptation, and some eat the marshmallow and some don't. Now, when you follow these children up a decade later, those who were able to withstand temptation had more friends, better academic performance, more motivation to succeed, and this was more highly correlated with their SAT scores than was their IQ. Low impulse control is associated with imprisonment and socioeconomic failure. The reason why impulse control is so important, it's such a basic characteristic, is that in order to get bigger rewards in the future, you have to put aside smaller rewards in the present. So having better impulse control opens up a wider range of more beneficial options over time. And for that reason, 10% of children in the US, New Zealand, and close to 10% in the UK are on Ritalin. It's not because there's been a viral epidemic causing a new disease, it's because of the problems of poor impulse control within the normal human spectrum. These aren't people at the bottom 2%, these are people who are being treated in the bottom 10%, because Ritalin makes a huge difference to educational achievement. Another drug that's recently been in the news is modafinil. This is a new form of wakefulness promoting agent that increases both dopaminergic and adrenergic transmission. It's been shown to increase memory, learning, higher executive function and attention. These sorts of enhancements not only have potential benefits for individuals through their education, but for society. Based on the removal of lead, a number of authors have estimated that a small 3% increase in IQ over a whole population would reduce poverty by 25% and welfare recipiency by 18%. That's a massive increase because of the effect of the left-hand tail. It would add 1.5% to GDP and $150 billion to the US economy. It's a massive increase. So the US military has been vigorously involved in cognitive enhancement to improve human performance. And one spokesperson for DARPA said, if all 4.1 billion people of working age had even a modest small increase in IQ, it would have the same beneficial effects as the introduction of the internet. So these things matter. In terms of morally relevant effects, many people are on selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors. These are drugs used to treat depression, but they also increase cooperation, reduce criticism of others, lead to fairer distribution of resources, and reduce rejection of unfair offers. They increase aversion to harming others to benefit larger groups. Again, not a clear moral enhancer, but morally significant effects. So for people on antidepressants, their moral behaviour is modified. So too with people on oxytocin-releasing agents, such as the oral contraceptive pill or glucocorticoids used to treat asthma. Oxytocin increases trust, increases trustworthiness, and increases cooperation within one's in-group, but reduces cooperation with out-group members. And in one study in Oxford, Sylvia Turbeck, one of our doctoral students, showed that the common drug propranolol reduces implicit racial bias. Not only do drugs have an effect on our moral behaviour, but so does direct stimulation of our brain. This can be done either magnetically or electrically. And in one study of using magnetic stimulation in the right temporoparietal junction, an area involved in ascribing mental states to other people, subjects who were stimulated judged attempts to harm other people as being less wrong when they were unsuccessful, even though they were intentional. Again, electrical stimulation has been used to improve people's ability to lie and for other morally relevant behaviour. As I mentioned, even the most basic parts of our life, such as our loving relationships, follow patterns that we share with other mammals. There are three phases to all romantic relationships: lust, attraction, and attachment. Lust is a sexual urge to engage in sexual intercourse. Attraction is falling in love with the particular features of an individual, and attachment is a long-term pair bond that enables a couple to stay together long enough to rear their young. Each of these have different neurochemical and neurological bases. And for example, oxytocin has been used in psychological therapy to improve attachment in conjunction with counselling. Okay, so what else could we do? Well, of course, we can use genetic tests to select embryos that have more desirable genetic traits, and we can do genetic modification to enhance certain characteristics. This has been hugely effective in non-human animals. Mice have been created, Methuselah mice, where are they? That live twice as long as normal mice up there, and mice that are resistant to obesity or cancer, mice that can run up to 10 times as long, voles that are monogamous rather than polygamous, monkeys that work harder rather than being lazy. That shows the power of modifying biology to modifying behaviour. This is just a picture of a Schwarzenegger cow or a Belgian blue cow created by mimicking a mutation in a German family. Some of you may have seen in the news recently discussion of gene editing. This is very precise genetic engineering using a bacterial system called CRISPR and Cas9 to make very precise modifications to the human genome. And this was done last year by Chinese scientists on a human embryo. All right, so that's a rough overview of some of the prospects and some of the potential benefits. How should we think about this kind of activity of changing the underlying biology of human beings? And this is where I want to get to how I've thought about this over the last 10 years. This is the ethical bit. Ethics, in my view, is about reasons. It's about weighing reasons. And reasons are like vectors in physics. They have a direction and they have a strength. And what we ought to do, all things considered, is weighing these various reasons. So you're all familiar with this in different life, in ordinary life. There will be vectors of status that will push you towards certain cars. Cost will push in a different direction, and safety and perhaps reliability. This applies to buying a house or buying a car. And what you do is you weigh these reasons to come to an all things considered judgment. When it comes to human enhancement, exactly the same process should apply. We should weigh the reasons. Now, what are some of these reasons that are important in the human enhancement debate? Well, probably the most basic reason and the most important common currency of all ethical discourse is discussion of well-being, of what's good for people, what makes a good life. This is important to all of us. We want to have good lives. We want to look back on our lives and say, you know, that was a good life. That was better than what I could have done. So what makes up a good life? According to economists, it's satisfying your preferences. And indeed, capitalism is based on this view of what is valuable. But philosophers dating back to the ancient Greeks have thought about it more broadly. And there are traditionally three schools of thinking around human well-being. According to hedonists, what matters is happiness or pleasure and absence of unhappiness and pain. It's feeling happy about how your life is going or your decisions. According to desire fulfillment or preference satisfaction theorists, what matters is satisfying your preferences or getting what you want, usually suitably qualified, knowing full information or available information about the relevant options. But an important school of thought, which I think captures an important part of the truth, is that there are certain things that are good or bad for the human animal in virtue of its nature as a human animal, so-called objective goods. And people will have different theories of what's objectively good, and we don't have time to discuss the many different theories. But as a social animal, social relationships are important to human beings. Love, family, children, achievement, developing talents, creativity, some sort of physical life, and sex, potentially items on the objective list. And what Derek Parfit, a philosopher here, has said is the best life is the area in this intersection that is engaging objectively valuable activities that make us happy, that we wish to engage in. Importantly, though, this aspect is often what's at issue in debates around human enhancement. Another important reason is one of freedom and autonomy, the ability to shape your life as you believe best for you. Not necessarily which is best in terms of well-being, but best according to your values. The third basic value is one of justice. Now, there are many theories of justice, and often what's at issue is what kind of theory you're appealing to, whether it's equality, utilitarianism, which says distribute goods so as to bring about the greatest amount of benefit, or prioritarianism, or a right to a fair go, which says bring as many people up above some kind of threshold as possible. And I'll come to these three different vectors in a moment when I consider some of the objections. Now, one of the standard objections to biological modifications of human beings is safety. You hear this in the gene editing debate. Gene editing's not safe. You've heard it in the cloning debate, and so on. Whenever some new procedure comes, people say, well, it's not safe, therefore we ought to ban it. Now, appropriate response to safety is, first of all, to do research and not to prohibit. So when it comes to gene editing, if it has risks, we should do research and not introduce it clinically. But safety is not an objection to doing research. And in all safety objections, it's important to consider the status quo when comparing the risks of the intervention. So when people say steroids are risky, steroids are incredibly safe in the physiological range. Rugby is very dangerous. People break their necks and are left paralysed. The risks of professional full contact sport are much greater than the risks of biological enhancements given within the physiological range. And the problem with the safety objection is it's a very weak objection, because when that procedure that is currently unsafe becomes safer than the status quo, the safety objection turns on its head. So when people say cloning is unsafe as a method of reproduction, you have to remember that natural reproduction is quite risky and inefficient. Only 1 in 5 embryos goes on to produce a live-born baby, and 5% of those babies are abnormal. So if cloning were ever better than that, on this argument, you should employ cloning rather than natural reproduction, and indeed IVF, when its efficiency and safety surpasses natural reproduction. What matters is, importantly, not absence of risk, because life is never absent of risk. It's that risk is reasonable. That is, the risks are minimized and that the risks are commensurate with the benefits and the alternatives, and that people consent to the risks where possible. And I'll come to the case of children who can't consent. Now, one of the most basic principles in a liberal society is John Stuart Mill's harm principle. Now, Mill famously said that the sole end for mankind, for which mankind are warranted individually or collectively in interfering with the freedom of any of their number, is self-protection, that is, of mankind. That is, the only purpose for which power can rightfully be exercised over any member against his will is to prevent harm to others. His own good, that is, harm to self, is never a sufficient warrant. But that's precisely the principle which is not respected in most of the regulation over human biological enhancement. So again, we only have to consider some of the applications of the new biology. Sex selection, many of you will be familiar with. You can now do sex selection reliably and efficiently by using IVF and selecting the sex, an embryo of the sex that you desire. And that's banned in this country. It's even banned if you're already having IVF. So if you're having IVF and having genetic diagnosis to eliminate a genetic disorder, what you can't do is say, oh, and I'd like to have a girl, or and I'd like to have a boy. Now, who is that decision harming if you decided to do that? The standard answer is it's going to create a sex ratio imbalance. Look at what happened in India and China, where the sex ratio is 6 males to 5 females. But if that was your reason for interfering in people's liberty to make this choice, then it's easy to give them freedom while also protecting the sex ratio. You can monitor the sex ratio, or you can only allow it for what's called family balancing, where there's already a child of one sex and you want to have a child of a different sex. And in fact, in the US and the UK and Australia, that's what people want. 90% of couples want sex selection for family balancing, and 50% of them choose girls. So there's no good harm-based argument for the total prohibition of sex selection. Likewise, you're not allowed to select for anything other than against serious diseases in this country. Now, why is that? Who would you be harming if you selected for the, say, ACTN3 gene that's associated with, one version is associated with ability in sprint events, another one is associated with ability in endurance events. Very weak association, but why is it banned? You're not harming anyone if you select for that. Or another case of eugenic selection that's not allowed, monoamine oxidase A, this is the so-called warrior gene, comes in two variants, the high activity variant, the low activity variant. 1/3 of you will have the low activity variant, and 2/3 will have the high activity variant. Now, it makes no difference normally in life, unless you're abused as a child. If you're abused or neglected as a child and you have the low activity variant, you're very likely to develop an impulse control disorder, be violent, end up in jail. If you have the high activity variant and you're neglected or abused, you're resistant to the effects of the abuse. You tend not to end up in jail. Now, it doesn't make any difference if you have a normal environment, but if you're in a disadvantaged environment, it makes a difference. Now, what would be the problem with allowing people to make a choice over that kind of gene? To say they've got 10 embryos, none of them have cystic fibrosis or Down syndrome or the conditions you're allowed to test for, and they say, well, we'd like to have a child with the high activity variant. Again, it's banned in this country. Save Your Siblings was banned until recently. So Save Your Siblings is the case where you have a child with leukemia or a child with a disorder, and there's no bone marrow donor available in the community. Now, you can create a bone marrow donor by having another child who is a compatible, HLA-compatible, a tissue type-compatible donor. So in order to make sure that you have a child who's compatible, you can use IVF and genetic diagnosis and select an embryo that's a compatible tissue donor. Now, until recently, this was banned, but it doesn't harm anyone, and it benefits a child with leukemia. So again, a violation of the harm principle. Cloning is another example where you could clone today. You could take an embryo and you could split it in half and create identical twins deliberately. Okay. Now, that would harm the original embryo, so it would divide that embryo in half. If you think destroying an embryo is wrong, you'll think this is wrong. But if you don't have an opposition to embryo destruction, deliberately creating identical twins is not going to harm anyone. And that's a form of cloning that's available today. So, of course, there are a lot of objections to all of these sort of arguments. I'm just highlighting some of the style of objections and why principles like the harm principle are very important to push back and say, why do we have laws that ban these sorts of practices? Okay, another common reason that's related to this, so take the Save Your Sibling case that people give. People are very concerned about respecting human dignity and treating people as an end. Immanuel Kant is famous for this principle. I think it's one of his formulations of humanity. He says, and this is always brought out in European discussions of reproductive technologies or genetic interventions. So Kant said, act in such a way that you treat humanity, whether in your own person or in the person of any other, never merely as a means, but always at the same time as an end. And so what these individuals who oppose the creation of Save Your Siblings say is, you're using that child as a means to save the life of another child. Or you're you're using eugenic selection, the ACTN3 gene, because you want to have an athlete. So you're using that child to realise your own failed dreams to be an Olympic athlete. Or you're using that child to become a musical genius by selecting for perfect pitch, which again, there is a gene that's associated with perfect pitch. So they claim that there's a violation of this categorical imperative or this formulation of humanity to treat people always as an end. Now, what is a violation of this principle? It's slavery. It's treating people purely as a means. Now, when you create a Save Your Sibling, are you treating that child purely as a means? Well, you might be. If you gave birth to the child, took the bone marrow and killed the child, that would be treating the child purely as a means. If you bring up that child as any other child, give the child the same opportunities as the other children, the same kind of love, the same sorts of prospects, that's not treating the child purely as a means. That's treating the child as a means, but also as an end. Just as when you buy some goods from a shopkeeper, you're treating them as a means, but also as an end when they consent to do that. So likewise for cloning. If you were to clone somebody in order to realise the dreams which you never had and treated them in that way, that would be using the child as a means. But having a child as a clone has no necessary connection with how they're treated. So one of the standard examples that I used to give in the cloning debate is, imagine that you're a couple and you've delayed reproduction and you're now 40 and you've had IVF and you've produced one embryo. This is your only chance of having a child. And the embryo is implanted and the pregnancy is going along well, and you're involved in a car accident. And the placenta is ruptured. And it looks like you're going to lose the pregnancy and there are no more embryos. You could take a skin cell off that fetus and use it to clone another embryo to replace that fetus if the pregnancy miscarried. Now, what would be the problem with that application of cloning? Would that be treating the child as a means to an end? It's hard to see how it would be. So one of the examples that people give of a violation of this sort of means end principle is Lang Lang. So Michael Sandel, Jürgen Habermas, many famous philosophers have objected to the new biology by claiming that it would result in a kind of hyperagency of a control of parents over their children that would constrict the child's open future, that would constrict the child's freedom. And the sort of person they have in mind is Lang Lang. And his father famously told him to commit suicide after he failed to get into the Beijing Central Conservatory of Music at the age of 9. He spent hundreds of thousands of hours practicing on the piano. Now, even in this case, which is one of the most extreme cases of control of parents over a child, it's not clear that the child was treated purely as a means. You'd have to evaluate how well his life has gone and also his own autonomy today and his own views about the life. But importantly, even if this was a case of hyperagency, he wasn't cloned and he wasn't genetically selected. What was wrong was the parental behaviour. So bringing someone into the world through a particular biological route says nothing about the way in which they are necessarily treated. So cloning was said to be an affront to human dignity, and in fact the European Union banned it on that basis. And again, identical twins are clones. 1 in 300 pregnancies are identical twins. It's hard to see how they are an affront to human dignity. And it's hard to see how the child who was born from the skin cell of a fetus that was about to miscarry is an affront to human dignity. So human dignity is an example of one of the basic mistakes in modern bioethical argument. It's using a motherhood statement as a trump card in order to silence any kind of debate, to silence any search for reasons in that particular case. Now, one of the ways of testing whether we are biased, there's been a huge movement around psychological biases, Kahneman's heuristics and biases, his book Thinking Fast and Slow, shows that we structure the world by viewing it according to psychological spectacles that shape our choices. But the same thing applies to our moral choices. And one of the ways to test whether we're biased is to use thought experiments and heuristics. And this is one which I call the preservation test. So many people are opposed to enhancing their children if they're normal. But take some valuable property, and here I've got IQ, but it could be impulse control or level of empathy. And assume that your child is high on that property and the child is going along perfectly well and then suddenly develops a condition where that will drop but be perfectly average. So it's gone from high to average. The average IQ is 100. 160 is a genius. And let's assume that in order to prevent this drop, you can do something very simple like giving vitamin B1 every day. Now, if you don't give the vitamin B1, this child is still normal, but it's worse off than it would otherwise have been. It's harmed. You have to have a good reason not to give the vitamin B1. Could be expensive, could have side effects, might not be available. But absent some reason, you should give the vitamin B1, right? You would be wrong not to give the vitamin B1. Okay, so that's preservation. Now let's consider enhancement. Your child's born absolutely average, going along, and it develops a condition such that if you give it vitamin B1, its IQ will rise to 160, or its impulse control will go up, or it become more empathetic or more musical or whatever it is you think is valuable, according to a plausible theory of well-being. Again, if you don't give the B1, the same state of affairs arises. The child ends up with a property that's average, but not as good as it could have been. The child is harmed. It's worse off than it would have been. In both cases, you need good reasons not to give the vitamin B1. Now, if I change B1 to gene editing, the only morally relevant difference is that gene editing is associated with side effects, or it's passed on to the next generation. So you have to show that those side effects are so significant as to outweigh the benefit or the avoidance of harm of that intervention. So this is an argument from everyday dietary intervention to something that would be a more fundamental biological intervention. Sometimes people ask me what sorts of principles should govern ethics. And I've talked about well-being. For utilitarians and consequentialists, the right action is just the action which maximises well-being. And that's a very demanding ethic, because it implies that you ought to give up your life now and save 5 or 8 people who have got organ failure, because that's 1 life versus 8. So, or you've got 2 kidneys, according to consequentialism, you ought to give 1 to somebody else now. And it's wrong of you not to give 1 of your kidneys. I think that's too demanding. What's much more plausible as a basic ethical principle is what's called the duty of easy rescue. When the cost to you is small and the benefit to others is large, you ought to do that thing. So you ought to give blood, and particularly you ought to give your organs after you've died, because then they're of no use to you whatsoever and they could save 7, 8 lives. So the duty of easy rescue is a very basic duty that consequentialists would endorse, but also contractualists, people who argue that we should choose rules from behind a veil of ignorance. We would all benefit if we all did easy rescues. You say, well, that's pretty obvious. Well, how many of you are organ donors? How many of you are blood donors? This would also apply to giving data to research. Yeah, we have massive levels of privacy control over our data. Sperm, eggs, and even embryos. It's very little cost to you to donate an embryo that would otherwise be discarded for the benefit of a childless couple. So a duty of easy rescue would have significant impact over these sorts of decisions. Another basic concept that comes up, so particularly in the enhancement debate, is one of coercion and exploitation. So people say we shouldn't allow doping in sport or cognitive enhancement in university because it will coerce people. It will force people to take who don't want to take steroids or modafinil to have to take them in order to compete. Now, coercion means getting someone to do something that you want by reducing their freedom. The paradigm example of coercion is your money or your life. You no longer have the option of both your money or your life. Your freedom is changed. Now, coercion can be quite benign. If I say to my small child, eat your vegetables or you don't get dessert, that's coercion. Okay. Now, if the status quo is still available, it's not coercion. If I say, eat your vegetables, but if you don't eat them, I'll give you dessert, that's not coercion. That's just asking someone or even commanding someone. But provided they have the same range of options. Now, people who choose not to take modafinil or choose not to take steroids in sport are still able to compete. What's happened is that they're less competitive than they would have been if they'd taken. So it's not hard coercion. It's not like your money or your life. But their argument may be that they're no longer as competitive without that intervention. Now, notice that there are many things that will reduce our competitiveness, such as training less, or studying less, or sleeping less. Now, can somebody object in sport to say, well, I don't want to train for 8 hours a day, but I need to in order to be competitive? That would be a very implausible objection. And the reason is that it's safe to travel to train 8 hours a day. It's safe enough. So the moral of this story is that even if you're less competitive, whether there's been a harm to you depends on whether the intervention that you now have to take is risky or unreasonably risky. So to take another example of a drug or a substance that used to be banned, caffeine used to be banned in sport. It's safe, but it also increases time to exhaustion by 10%. You now have to take caffeine to be competitive. That's not coercive, because it's deemed safe enough. A related concept is exploitation. This is getting someone to do something that you want by taking advantage of some kind of background injustice. And when people object to paying people to take risk, what they're really objecting to is exploitation, not coercion. So when you offer people $100,000 for their kidney, you're not coercing them, you're exploiting them. Now, one of the examples of using bioenhancements in law is the use of this drug, cyproterone acetate, which is used to reduce libido in paedophiles in Europe, or so-called chemical castration. This was used on the famous computer scientist Alan Turing, who was credited with contributing to breaking the Enigma code. He was also a homosexual and had to take it to avoid imprisonment. So in parts of Europe and the United States, this is either mandatory or offered as an alternative to imprisonment. Now, if it's offered as an alternative and the background punishment is just, it's not coercion. It's only coercion if it's on the background of an unjust punishment or an increased punishment. So again, proper use of the concept is important. It's important to remember that, again, coercion is not a trump card. There are many things which are coercive. So children are forced to take a certain kind of diet or to be educated to enhance them. Now, I'll finish with this case because I want to leave some time for questions. I mentioned modafinil, Ritalin before. There was a study from Sweden a couple of years ago that showed that for adult prisoners convicted of a violent crime, if you placed the males on Ritalin, you would reduce violent reoffence by 40% and females by 30%. That's a very significant reduction. Now, should that be compulsory? It would reduce people's freedom if you required prisoners to take modafinil in one sense, not modafinil, Ritalin, but you would also increase impulse control. So you would enhance freedom in the sense of opening up longer term options, and you would also likely enhance well-being. So arguably, the use of Ritalin in people with attention deficit disorder and violent crime is a moral enhancer that enhances autonomy and well-being. So I think it's an open question whether the state could require the use of Ritalin as a part of rehabilitation. All right, let me finish. One core concept in ethics is moral responsibility. Moral responsibility for an outcome is dependent on two functions. One is the foreseeability of that outcome and the avoidability of that action. So if I couldn't foresee that I was going to do harm, I'm not responsible, and if I couldn't avoid it, I'm not responsible. Blame is a function of the harm and the degree of moral responsibility. Now, I believe there's no distinction between the foreseen effects of our actions and the foreseen effects of our omissions. And I don't believe that intending something is any morally different from merely foreseeing it. Now, these are controversial distinctions. Some people draw both of those distinctions. But it's important to look at what is happening in the status quo. So, over the last 30 years, empathy has been reducing. Now that we know that that's the case in the US, in college-age students, meta-analysis of all psychological studies involving empathy measures, now that we know that empathy is reducing, we should ask the moral question, is that a good thing? And you need a value there. You need to put a value on empathy. It might be a really good thing. Maybe we should increase it. Or maybe it's a bad thing and we should reduce it. But we now have the means to start to control empathy through our knowledge of science, in particular in biology. So all humans are different, and that difference has normative significance. 1% of humanity are psychopaths. That's 70 million psychopaths in the world. only takes one of those to decide to construct a smallpox virus in a backyard laboratory, and there'll be hundreds of millions of people killed. And you're all familiar with, he's certainly a psychopath, Ted Bundy. I'm not going to go through conceptual analysis or addiction. How can we make progress using our knowledge of science? We need to start by understanding our limitations, physical, moral, emotional. And we need to evaluate all options. I haven't argued that the only way to address inequality is through biological means. We should consider all four of these mechanisms and evaluate their costs and benefits and their impacts on justice and other reasons. But we shouldn't exclude modifying ourselves on the view that we're some kind of being made in the image of God. We're animals that are products of evolution with many inbuilt limitations. So in this talk, I have outlined a number of reasons. And importantly, none of these reasons rules out fundamental biological manipulation. I haven't said that we ought to be engaging in cloning. I haven't said we ought to be selecting more intelligent children. Importantly, ethics is context sensitive. It's not that ethics is relative to people's preferences or cultural norms. It's relevant relative to the circumstance in which you find yourself. We don't need laws that prevent people from having severely ill or disabled children because we're a wealthy society. If there were an epidemic and millions of children would be born severely disabled or severely ill, it may well be that public interest considerations justify increasing infringements of freedom. This happened in Cyprus when thalassemia threatened to bankrupt the health budget and exhaust the blood supply. The church introduced mandatory carrier testing of couples wanting to be married. A very small infringement of freedom completely eradicated thalassemia because every couple that found that they were at risk of having a child decided voluntarily to go on and have termination of pregnancy. So whether cloning ought to be banned depends on whether you're talking about cloning of the last embryo or fetus or cloning of 96 replicas of Adolf Hitler, which is the subject of the Boys from Brazil film. So what I hope I've shown is that how we should regulate ought to be on considerations such as the harm principle, whether we can realise benefit to people, whether it's consistent with justice. But there is no clear answer from the outset. And the challenge that I think Jim Martin gave us is to use ethics to be able to reap the benefits of the biological revolution while also attempting to reduce its risks ethically. Thank you.
Okay, there's a huge amount to unpack there. So if I could ask, when you're asking a question, A, please do make sure it's a question and not your own contribution to the debate. That's really important with a subject like this. And B, keep it brief, and I will be a little bit bullish if you're not. And just one further note, this is being live webcast and recorded, so the normal caveat applies. If you don't want your voice or face to be on film or on the web, please don't ask a question. Get your companion to ask it for you. Right, we'll get cracking, and I've noticed a hand up here already.
How realistic do you really think it is that somebody would construct a weapon of mass destruction? There seems to be a natural aversion since Hiroshima and Nagasaki.
Well, we just saw this event in Paris. I don't think that you know, if that group of people had access to a biological weapon, they would have decided ethically that they weren't going to do it. And as I said, 1% of the population are psychopaths. And on top of that, you've got antisocial personality disorder, you've got fanatics and ideologues. And so I think it's inevitable that you will see kind of massive events. So Jonathan Glover, who I have enormous respect for, gave a paper here the other week. His concern is privacy and the surveillance that the government's employing under the sort of so-called, you know, threat of terror. He's very concerned about that.
and the infringement on people's privacy. I think it's a much more difficult question. I think we're, as Jim, you know, foreshadowed, entering uncharted territory. And people often say, well, you know, we haven't extinguished ourselves so far, you know, we should be optimistic. And I just think that, sound like one of these people in the Middle Ages, sort of, you know, the time of the plague, you know, predicting the end of the world. But, you know, my reading of it is we've just reached a different time where technology is putting in the hands of people massive power. So I think it's likely.
Who's next? Got one. Oh.
So an issue you touched on was the individual autonomy of children when dealing with decisions that their parents might make. And so a question I was wondering is, what are your thoughts on the restrictions placed upon children's individual, I guess, autonomy by genetic enhancements, if their parents are choosing what traits the parents think are most beneficial to the child?
Yeah, so I think this is a very good question, and this is what many people are concerned about, that the parents will be choosing for their children. First point, though, just remember, nature is going to choose something. And so something is going to be chosen. You're not going to have an open slate of you're going to have this or that, and it's whether nature chooses or your parents. So can your parents do better than nature? You may think not. That's why perhaps we need to have greater constraints on parents choosing, and that needs to be based on some plausible conceptions and some reliable evidence that those characteristics will track greater opportunities in life. But I think that you have to realise that sometimes you have to bite the bullet and say, you know, is nature good enough? So I drew that curve for IQ. If my child was down in the bottom third of IQ or impulse control or one of these characteristics, and I had the chance to select an embryo that wasn't in that area, I would choose it. Because in my view, it's not because I want the child to be a certain way. I want that child to have a reasonable range of opportunities, and I think the evidence just supports that they do have a wider range of opportunities. And a kind of parallel case is intersex conditions. So children are sometimes born with, say, androgen insensitivity syndrome, where biologically they're male, but the receptors to testosterone aren't working, or they may be partially working. And so the child will, in the case of partial androgen insensitivity syndrome, have some features of being male and some features of being female. And what was historically done was doctors said, you have to assign a sex. You have to be a male or be a female. The child will be teased. The parents won't be able to accept the child. So you have to assign. And that typically was creating a female, because it was excision of a very large clitoris and fashioning of a sort of fuller vagina and removal of intra-abdominal testes. That was the standard surgical approach. We had a project on this, and we interviewed, and I met quite a lot of intersex people. And some of them said, we wish that we had been left alone to make our own decisions, you know, at the time we could, about whether to be male or female or not, you know, what sort of surgery to have or not have. And I'm persuaded by them. That in that case, again, if I had a child with an intersex condition, I would probably, you know, leave the child alone. But I don't think that what doctors did was necessarily wrong. I think you have to bite the bullet. You've got two alternative tracks in life. You've got potentially higher levels of acceptance and adjustment psychologically, but a worse anatomical and perhaps, you know, sexual outcome. Or you've got the risks of that sort of psychological adjustment issue, but more choice in the future. And they're just different options. And you can't just say, well, we'll leave it to nature. You have to, in my view, make a decision about which of those is better for the child. And sometimes, you know, both options will be reasonable options. So I think there's a mistake to think that by not intervening, we're somehow maximising the child, we're benefiting the child and maximising the child's freedom. We're not. We're choosing a trajectory, and that may be a better trajectory or it may be a worse trajectory. So unfortunately, in kids, you have to make a decision. Now, because they're going to experience the harm, not you, the threshold for making the decision has to be higher. So you might say, I want to be a female tomorrow, and you go and have a sex change operation. That's up to you. And you wouldn't do that on a child just for trivial reasons. But sometimes sex change, you know, operations or puberty is delayed in children, you know, as people make a decision.
Who's next? Sorry, Caroline, back down at the back.
You mentioned many big global problems at the beginning. One was terrorism, another was climate change as an ethical issue of a tragedy of the commons. So I was wondering if you could possibly elaborate a bit more about the potential of human enhancement to deal with that problem as an ethical issue.
Well, the sort of human moral enhancement field is like the study of cancer 100 years ago. It's sort of, you know, mixing a few chemicals here and there and seeing some effects. And you know, there isn't a biological enhancement that is going to sort of cure climate change. However, there is, and what we're doing in Oxford ourselves is trying to understand the psychology and indeed the neuroscience and neurobiology behind cooperative behaviour and what triggers people to choose to behave and make sacrifices and what, you know, encourages them to free ride. So treating them as laboratory rats in essence. And one of them is, so we've got a couple of interesting findings. One of them is reputation. So when people's choices are made visible, they're much more willing to engage in what's called costly helping, making small sacrifices to benefit others. So when their choices aren't public, they behave quite selfishly, and when they're public... and another study that a social psychologist from Belgium... Holland, Paul Van Lang, has done with our group, is he's looked at the rates of charitable giving in different populations. And what he's found is that factors like religion, whether you're religious or not, whether you're male or female, education, these factors don't significantly affect how much people are prepared to give to others. What affects them most is population density. And the lower the population density, the more they give. And his hypothesis is people know each other more, they're less anonymous. Is the hypothesis in smaller communities, and so they're more willing. So trying to harness those sorts of psychologies, I think, is one of the ways you could start to get traction on those problems. Another area is education. What I think we urgently need is a secular moral education, you know, an education in reasons and different values and trying to understand how we can encourage the acquisition of values like willingness to engage in easy rescue, which I think is such a no-brainer, but people still don't donate their organs. And maybe biology will play a role in that. So our colleague here, Roy Cohen-Gadosh, has been involved in this thing, and we've written a report with the Martin School, a policy paper on transcranial electrical stimulation. This is used to enhance numeracy, language acquisition, motor skills. It electrically stimulates an area of the brain and raises the potential so the brain fires more easily, essentially. Now, again, early days, no reason in principle why you couldn't use that for the acquisition of moral skills. So, for example, no reason why you couldn't attempt to increase empathy with some sort of training paradigm. And maybe that's what education will look like in 20 years. Once we move beyond religious education and faith-based schools, to an education that has some kind of common secular morality with a sort of a set of values that we want. So, you know, how might it affect children? It might affect, you know, policies that are based on harnessing people's psychology, or, you know, it could involve direct modification of biology.
In terms of enhancements and improvements, is that what Hitler was trying to do with the Hitler Youth?
Yeah, I mean, everyone has their own view of enhancement, and one of the sort of skeptical kind of views in ethics is, you know, well, you know, Hitler, or, you know, in the Victorian times, people would have enhanced patriotism. We say what we really need is more patriotic citizens. So what you're going to enhance is, first of all, going to be relative, and it's also going to be determined by the very flawed people who are in need of enhancement. This is what's called a bootstrapping problem. And I agree that's a problem. But notice that it's a problem for any society. I mean, Hitler didn't have enhancements, but he had gas chambers and weapons and so on. So, you know, how you organise society has to have values, and the values that you choose are going to fundamentally affect what sort of society that you had. So one of Jonathan Glover's examples, I mean, his main example about the problems of government surveillance, was from East Germany under the communists. The Stasi had obtained the love letters of a woman and invaded her sort of her privacy. And that's clearly a bad thing, but the Stasi, I think, are a completely different form of government today. I mean, I'm not a great fan of the British government, but I do think they're better than the Stasi. And so you're going to have values, and the sort of the biological enhancement project is just a small part of that. And we're going to have to get the values issue right. And all we can do is try and make progress and identify our biases and identify our mistakes and try to make progress. But if we're to address the threat of biological weapons and nuclear war and global cooperation and global poverty, you know, we're going to have to come off the relativist fence and try to do better.
There was one here.
If the future scenario would be the enhancement, and I guess there would be also money involved with these things, like in the same way as IVF, so IVF is quite expensive. It seems to me that only the privileged people, especially financially well-off people, will have access to the enhancements. Is there a risk that at some point people born with those enhancements will have access to the best jobs? So there will be a new type of discrimination. So you can get this job if you are perfect, and people who did not have that privilege would be rejected.
Yeah, so I skipped over, very good, and that's actually probably the commonest objection. And there's a film called Gattaca that is based on this two-tier society of the genetic elite and the genetic haves and the genetic have-nots. And this is the concern that many people have, that not only will you become rich, you'll be able to entrench privilege into your genes and the genes, you know, of your children. And that's certainly a risk. You know, there's no doubt that you could massively increase inequality. But it's not inevitable. And when people have this social determinist view, you may be familiar with this idea of genetic determinism, that our fate is in our genes, which is clearly false. Genes are just a part of the causal story. But likewise, social determinism is false, that we must realise, Gattaca, that this is beyond our control. And Jim Watson, when I first ran a human enhancement conference in 2003, was giving a keynote there, and he said, it's the bottom one-third I worry about. And he said, I think enhancements and selection should be available to people in the bottom one-third. So at the moment, disease is treating the bottom 2%. Disease is just two standard deviations below the mean. So if your IQ is 69, you get medical therapy. You get, you know, medical treatment. If it's 71, you can't, because that's normal. Now, you could expand, which is really what's happened, the disease category, and say, well, we're going to give social support through the NHS to people below 90 or in the bottom one third, and that would reduce inequality. And the other thing which I'll say is that it's true that in reality, these things are usually made available on the market, and that creates inequality. But it's also true that inequality decreases over time in one sense. If you look at mobile phones as an example of a communications enhancement, initially really expensive, exotic technology, now ubiquitous and completely revolutionised the world. Now, IVF has come down in cost and it will be very cheap. You know, at some point it's going to be very cheap. So if you're looking at the whole of human history, it may be that there's a period of time where there is a big gap, but typically that gap has reduced in terms of the cost. Now, new things come and then there's a new gap, so I don't think that answer is completely satisfactory, but I think it really is up to us. And if it's important, you ought to make it available, you know, through the NHS. So should people, you know, have subsidised IVF to choose the hair colour of their children or the eye colour? No. Makes no difference to their well-being and, you know, virtually no difference, completely, you know, largely irrelevant characteristic that they can change. Should they have NHS, you know, IVF to select against low but normal impulse control? Sure. That's going to make a big difference to society and to their children. But that's not how we have this bright line between disease and health. And that is a statistical line. It's a line of no normative significance.
So that was a largely optimistic lecture. What would you think is the greatest harm or risk associated with human enhancement?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question. So let me just take the cloning debate. I think the best objection to cloning, and it's not a, again, it's not a an overwhelming objection, but it's a lack of originality. It's a constriction. So you often hear this objection of diversity, that we need diversity as a species, and I think that's a mistake in one sense. You don't need biological diversity today to withstand the HIV epidemic because we develop drugs and preventative strategies. And in terms of diseases, you could engineer diversity, biological diversity for disease resistance, I think, is overrated. But when it comes to diversity of human creativity and experience and so on, I think there is a plausible argument that we would tend to constrict that, and that may be worse for us over the long term. So not that everyone will choose blonde hair and blue-eyed children, but, you know, for example, mental illness and creativity. So maybe there's an association between manic depression and creativity, or autism spectrum disorders and some positive thing. And I think that area is one where we could easily go wrong through herd behaviour or inadequate information. And I don't think it's a reason to regulate, but I think it's a reason to keep an eye on and encourage diversity. So although I personally have argued that deafness is a disability, it's not just a difference, I can give you the arguments if you want, I still think that deaf people ought to be free to deliberately select a deaf embryo. I think they're doing the wrong thing, but I think we have the resources to encourage that kind of freedom and diversity, you know, at least, you know, in Western Europe. So I personally think this is a little bit like the sort of playing God, we don't really know what we're dealing with, it's all more complicated than we think objection, which I, in this sense, I think has some weight, but I don't think it has the weight of people who want to shut down the whole program. Because I think, again, ethics is, I mean, so take ranking lives. People object to my view, I have this view that we ought to select the best embryo. We've got a moral obligation, and people hate this. But again, I can give you the argument. But one of the objections is, oh, you're committed to this ranking from, you know, number one to number 7 billion of all the possible embryos, and there's a one. And that's just nonsense. That there will be lives that are clearly better and clearly worse, and then ones in the grey zone. And I think I think we need to be wary of over-precisely ordering and valuing when things are either imprecise or simply not commensurable. And so we need, in that sense, need to be humble about, you know, just concentrating on the black and white and not thinking that we can create a ranking from one onwards. And I think that's the greatest danger.
I think I saw another hand at the
back. And the other main danger, which I talked about before, is dual use. I mean, using this to actually cause harm. So, you know, every powerful intervention can be misused, but that's obvious.
Sort of on that note, are you optimistic about our political institutions' ability to regulate if we remove outright bans on many of these technologies to promote the positive applications and prohibit the negative applications of these technologies?
So Francis Fukuyama wrote this book when the Berlin Wall fell called The End of History, where he said, you know, we'd reached this final pinnacle point of human history that democracy had proven itself to be the, you know, superior political system. And I think that events since then have just shown how wrong that is. Democracy is totally unsuited to dealing with global collective action problems like climate change. Democracy is totally unsuited to dealing with any long-term threat or benefit because you've got a three-year electoral cycle. You know, capitalism is totally unsuited to those. Capitalism is great as a driver of creativity and it makes people accountable for their own actions. So it's been dominant as a way of regulating human behaviour. But to think that either of these systems is satisfactory for dealing with, you know, biological weapons or climate change, I think, you know, is just wrong. I mean, they have served us well, but I don't think that they are suited. Now, what's the alternative? I don't know. But I think we should be, again, you know, my argument in the moral bioenhancement issue has not been that we ought to go out and put Prozac in the water and solve climate change that way, which is what people crudely, you know, accuse me of. All I've said is we ought to do research into this. You know, we ought to look at human limitations, and we ought to look at biology as a sort of as a potential avenue for dealing with those. And likewise, I think we ought to be looking at alternatives to capitalism and democracy as a way of you know, living. And it's a mistake to think that we've reached the end of history. So I don't think we will deal with it. And, you know, the issue, like I showed you that picture of the Chinese scientists, I think they did the right thing. I think the gene editing research, it was totally ethical. They used a tri-pronuclear embryo that would never develop, right? Couldn't live, so it was going to die. They were accused of, you know, and Nature and Science both refused to publish that paper, partly on ethical grounds. Really, totally, totally mistaken. But what will happen is this sort of research will be done. China is spending millions, hundreds of millions of dollars of trying to identify all the genes associated with intelligence. Massively more than we are in the West. So, you know, this will be done in parts of the world. And the challenge of responsibility is to not create, as we do in doping, say, well, what we want is zero tolerance. What you want to do is be a responsible leader where you're exercising some control. And that requires not having, as Europe tends to do, these blanket bans. I mean, Europe is now, I was asked to give an opinion for CNN or something like that. I've staggered. Europe has now banned the products of the milk and products of cloned animals. And it's, you know, what century are we living in? You know, where, you know, the people that want to do that. So I don't have much hope for Europe as being a leader.
I think we've got time for one, maybe two more questions. So we've got one in the middle here.
What could some kind of negative effects be of skewing a normal distribution?
Sorry, could you say that again?
You have a normal distribution.
Yeah.
And if you say that the lower third gets a kind of treatment, you skew the distribution so that the average would be closer to the lowest value than the highest value. Could that have some negative consequences?
Yeah, look, I mean, no, I just casually have said these as one kind of prospect, and how, I guess the main point is, it's within our power to change that normal distribution. And we ought to change it if we've got reliable evidence that we know what the effects of our changes are, and we've got a reasonably plausible set of values to evaluate that change. How we should do that is not at all clear. So, for example,
you might say, well, shifting the curve 3 points to the right is not going to benefit anyone. But as I showed you, it has enormous social benefits. But even this is quite, this is why I think, you know, kind of, it's important to understand the science. Most people don't understand the science of doping. And they, so if you look at that, the right end of the normal distribution curve, the top 1% of people, the top 1%, the smartest 1% of people, and you look at the number of patents they produce. And patents is a kind of rough measure of originality, creativity at producing something that's socially useful. Right, so you look at the number of patents they produce, and you divide that top 1% into quartiles. The bottom quartile of the top 1% produces 3 times the average number of patents. It's quite a lot more. The top quartile of the top 1% produces 8 times as many. It's a vast increase. So even pushing somebody along in that part has very socially and personally beneficial effects, at least in terms of patent production. So you need to understand, like you say, you need to understand how, what the effects will be before you act. But the basic presumption of all of my work is that the opposition are the people who say that we ought to stay with the natural status quo. You can select against genes, but nothing else, diseases, but nothing else, or I think that just misunderstands the sort of Darwinian perspective.
That wasn't
probably God punishing me for talking about Darwin.
Okay, we've got time for one more, if anybody's got one. No, okay. Well, before I thank Julian, I do, as you will, our regulars will know, I want to highlight our upcoming events. Next Thursday's seminar is Professor Adrian Hill talking about prevent and protect vaccines and immune responses. The following week, which will be the last one of term, is Professor Tim Palmer, talking about climate prediction in the 2020s. If you haven't already signed up for our 10th anniversary lecture in the Sheldonian on Monday, I really recommend that you do. It's Lord Martin Rees talking about will technology's dark side eclipse humanity's bright future. Obviously, I think it ties in very well with what we've been, some of the aspects of what we've been talking about today. And for those of you who are more economically minded, on Tuesday, we have Lord Adair Turner talking about his new book, which looks at the origins of the financial crash and what we should do about it. So plenty coming up still. And one thing I forgot to say at the start, for those of you who come regularly, we now finally have guest Wi-Fi. So if you haven't already discovered it, please, next time you come, do feel free to log in. Sorry, I should have said that at the beginning. Well, you know, we like people to tweet, so if it encourages people, that's one technological enhancement I think we'll definitely applaud. So please join me in thanking Julian for what was a fascinating talk and a great Q&A.